eight tracks on a regular, don't get it confused. Man, I've developed a hell of a lit fuse. Dropping bombs, rocking songs with the rhythm and blues. Pop it on, pop along till you're ripping your shoes. Pop it on for the bong, or are you high on life? How high, cloud nine?
Destination Mars, a Great Yarmouth band of today. They record and shoot YouTube videos in their garage. Perhaps they are aptly named because for them the 60s music scene might as well be another planet. By contrast, there are many in the town who have lived through the 60s twice. Once as young rock and roll musicians, and for a second time as they approach 70 years of age. I'm going crazy with them rhythm and them blues, yeah. They try to stop me, but my body keeps on moving. But all that's changed, these two generations have a common love. Music. The Great Yarmouth of half a century ago was a very different place to today. A huge annual influx of holidaymakers and the burgeoning rock revolution meant there was a ready audience for popular music. If music was your first love, there was only one thing to do. Form a band.
I always wanted to be a drummer. My mother wanted me to play the piano, I had piano lessons, but I always had pictures of drummers. In my school books, there was all drawings of huge drum kits. This is what I've been obsessed with drumming. Right till now, I know, over 70 years old, still drum kits are kind of cool thing to me.
I never wanted to be in the limelight. I just wanted to enjoy playing with different musicians. And that's how it is for most professional musicians. You just do it because you enjoy doing it, you know.
When we first started, I remember being youngsters, and I think we were about 14, 1954 or something like that. We had this wonderful thing that came on the radio called Radio Luxembourg.
The 60s generation were ill-served by mainstream radio.
BBC was still playing symphony music 18 hours a day, you know, so really, for young people, it was the great escape.
You had a radio, which I used to have a little transistor, which I carried about with me everywhere I went. Through the streets, I bet people hated it, but my friend and I both had one tuned to Radio London.
And they used to play the American songs, which featured Chuck Berry, and obviously Bill Haley came along, and Jerry Lee Lewis. So they were basically the first people we've really heard, apart from the English artists, which there weren't that many then. And of course, we took to the Americans. And that dragged on until the 60s, when we all became really interested in doing our own. And it was skiffle.
I started off originally singing in a skiffle group in the middle 50s.
The skiffle was not that difficult to play. The music was fairly straightforward and simple, lively, and it developed from there.
We used to build the loudspeaker cabinets to put stuff in.
In the 60s, you had to be inventive if you wanted to form a band.
We took by-inch thick plywood and cut holes in it and stick them in. And that was all homemade. Our first few months anyway, the amplifiers were virtually homemade.
One of my schoolmates made a guitar from the Hobbies magazine. And he brought it into school and let me have a play on it, and I rather liked it and sort of carried on from there, really.
With little on the radio and the digital age a long way off in the future, there was a ready audience for live gigs.
We saw all sorts of people, Billy Fury, The Shadows, Billy J. Kramer, The Searchers. The list is endless, really.
We did hundreds of gigs. I know, because I kept the books. And one year we did more gigs than there were days in the year. And probably the greatest player we ever played with, who we didn't know who he was with Neil Christian and the Crusaders, and their lead guitarist was Jimmy Page.
And we got to know him a bit. He went on to play with the Yardbirds, then he achieved worldwide success and fame with Led Zeppelin. And I think that's my favourite memory.
For a young musician, an adoring fan base and the reflected glory of mixing with better-known touring bands were a great incentive.
Billy J. Crane, the Dakotas, the Searchers, I was writing the Trogs, I was writing all of, the Beatles.
Well, we backed Screaming Lord Sutch at the Goods Hotel. I think with the Ramblers when we backed Jerry and the Pacemakers at the Royal Hotel in Lowestoft.
Oh, really big stars came down. They weren't international superstars, but they were quite big time in Britain at that time.
We were on with a band called The Pretty Things, and they used to do very, very heavy music. We shared the same dressing room.
Even in those days, music was more of a passion than a pathway to riches, but at least they were guaranteed an audience.
There was queues round the block at the Floral Hall in Galston.
We used to go to the Floral Hall, and then on Sunday nights we would go to see some of the famous bands then at the Regent. And that was our life. We worked all day, Saturday mornings, and then Friday nights, Sunday nights, we went out.
Music in the 60s wasn't just a teenager thing, which it is, well, it is now to a certain extent. They'd go to the Floral Hall, and there'd be a hell of a mixed crowd. I mean, my dad, who used to drive us around at one time, he was in more into music than I was. He knew all the current hits.
Our parents used to come along, and their friends used to come along. And it was quite a mix. There were young people, obviously, because that was a good time to be young, I suppose, the 60s.
Only one Great Yarmouth band from the 60s got a real shot at the big time. Peter Jay and the Jayhawkers. Their 1962 recording of the Offenbach classical piece Can Can rose to number 19 in the charts.
I went to Norwich College and there was a band there who were looking for a drummer. And literally they came in one day and sort of said, I thought I was going to get beaten up actually. I said, Jay, are you the one with the drums? Not whether I could play or not. And I said, yeah, so that was how the Jayhawkers started. And then we started doing local gigs sort of around Norwich. And eventually the sort of studying went sort of down and down and down, and the band took over more and more. And we got offered a summer season in Great Yarmouth. We did that, and from there we had the big question, would you like to do a tour and go pro? And that's when we changed, which was probably about 2.5 years into the band. We used to practice in the windmill, which was the dad's theatre, and we used to practice in there in the winter, and it is cold, there is no heating. So literally to keep warm, the boys used to run up and down on the spot. And from that we started playing the William Tell Overture, which had been a hit for the Piltdown Men. And then we thought, we'll do another classical thing. Oh, we can do the Can Can. They can all jump up and down, finish with the splits. I'm the drummer, so I'm coming up with all these ideas. I didn't have to do it. And that was our sort of originally going to be the B-side of our first record. What happened? We got signed by Decca, and because we're an instrumental band, they gave us Joe Meek as our producer. Joe Meek, the legendary guy who did Telstar. He wrote the what was going to be the A-side. It was called Redskins, and then when they got to the actual thing and they said, what are you going to do for the B-side? Oh, we'll do Can Can, which is part of our act. And then Decca decided to release that as the A-side, and it sold really well, sold over 100,000, got to 19 in one of the charts. It was our most successful record. That was our sort of high spot, and this is in 1962. I made the fatal mistake of actually calling it Can Can 62, so it's impossible to kind of really rewind the dates now, so I've sort of dated myself.
Today, Peter Jay's career path has taken a different turn.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, today we proudly present all of our viewers in the Day of the Circus.
He now owns and runs the Great Yarmouth Hippodrome Circus. Stardom is only one form of success. Just a child in the 60s, but influenced by the vibrant Yarmouth music scene of the time, drummer Joseph Harlow could be described as Yarmouth's greatest musical secret.
I had an ear infection when I was about 6 or 7 years old, and I had to go in hospital to have operations because I'm now partially deaf. I've been partially deaf ever since.
Joe's musical career began in an unlikely way. He joined the Yarmouth Swimming Club.
I won the diving cup, so I went to this dinner and dance to get my cup, and there was a band playing, Morris Share and the Star Notes, but after a while, my dad said, there's so-and-so over there standing by the band, so like kids do, he sort of moved over there, and after a while he went away, and I was just sort of watching the drummer all night long.
Joe took his first drum lessons from Arthur Brighton, a friend of his father. He turned out to be the first of many mentors.
I heard about Trevor Koopman at the Tower Ballroom, and I gave him a call, and he took me home. I used to go see him every Sunday, and took lessons from him. And sometimes he used to take me around to see his band play. Years later, I went to London to sort of study under Martin Drew, who was one of the world's finest jazz drummers. I just went from band to band. I started off in a country and western band, then I went to a pop group, and then I started gigging with a lot of organists. And that's where I learnt to play everything, just sort of one instead of one thing. Just backing quite a few well-known people like Ray Lewis and the Drifters, and that was really sort of something. And Ronnie Carroll, I worked with him every night of the week. Well, I remember him years ago singing songs on the radio, but I never dreamt in a million years that I'd be in the same room as him, let alone backing him. Many are called, but few succeed. Like Joe, most musicians are grateful for any kind of career from what is a labour of love.
I wanna walk with you, I wanna talk with you, I wanna talk with you.
So what of today's young musicians? Can any amongst them hope to emulate the successes of the past?
My name is John Joe. I am 50% of Destination Mars, and this is
Rosie. I'm the other 50% of Destination Mars.
It's a bit of an eclectic mix between rap, pop, and dance. Basically, you have to go with the whatever the technology is, and it's opened the world up. It's connected the world. You can be sitting in a garage in Goulston, and you can share it all the way to Australia. For example, we're working with an Australian group. I think any band that's come before has obviously led the way for the future music. So they've always. Every band before was adding their own builder blocks to the tower, innit, basically.
Bad music, to me, really is sort of a platform for expressing yourself, really.
Yeah, what she said. Now, music for me is basically the same thing, so it's basically expression.
Yes.
Creation. Well, it's just your life, basically. Once you get into it, it's your life. That's all you can, only way to sum it up. Everything. There you go.
The music scene in Great Yarmouth is... It's okay at the minute, but it's not as good as what it could be.
But now? Not a lot. There's nothing much happening. It's all sort of gone. It's all gone. It's mostly sort of karaoke's and stuff like this. And the bands are not around anymore like they were. It's just the way people's tastes are different.
But at the same time, that's not to say you should give up on Yarmouth or there's no place here for it. If you've got the right outlook, you could say it's like, there's an opportunity to build something here.
There will. I think there's a will for it now, and we are sort of seriously talking about one of our other venues, the Empire, of doing a place where it could open the door for live bands, you know, and local bands, and bringing back the battle of the bands again. I think it's really important to do it somewhere.
Basically, going to try and bring the music scene back to Yarmouth as well.
Hopefully.
But we're not going to. We're going to also stray away from here. but we're also not going to forget our roots.
No, definitely not.